and I've been trying to do a couple of videos on what's going on in Syria. The reason I'm doing these is because I've seen a few videos on Syria which have been a bit of a little bit of an oversimplification, and also they're trying to paint a particular picture, and I think it's kind of cartoonish, to be honest. That I've seen, they start like this, that the Arab Spring swept through Syria and protesters demanded reform. Bashar al-Assad was a brutal dictator. He ordered a crackdown. The protesters took up arms to defend themselves. Army officers refused to fire on the protesters, joined the protest, and so on and so forth is usually the beginning sort of salvo. Oh yeah, just a little disclaimer that I wanted to put in there, which is that if you're the type of person who believes the media and that your country is tells the whole truth, all of the truth, and nothing but the truth, and everybody else is a big liar, then you're probably going to be pretty upset by this, and probably I advise that you maybe just watch your own media, and you'll be happy, because I want people to be happy. So, we'll go. In 2011, there were protests which began against President Bashar al-Assad's 10-year rule. These were mostly in rural areas. The protests were illegal under Syrian military law and were met by force, usually baton charges and tear gas, and in some cases live ammo, mostly fired into the air. There were some cases in the beginning of the police or security forces firing on the protesters, but later those were not to fire on the protesters unless their lives were threatened. And so the idea of a violent crackdown ordered by Bashar is a little bit disconcerting. It's a little bit off target. There were some casualties on both sides, both by police and protesters. There were unknown gunmen which fired on the protesters and on the police. It's my personal opinion that this was Al-Qaeda, just because they have been known to sort of live and thrive in these chaotic situations, and Al-Qaeda expressed interest quite early on to the protest movement.
It's impossible for anyone in this state to give order to kill.
Do you feel guilty?
I did my best to protect the people, so you cannot feel guilty when you do your best. You feel sorry for the life that has been lost, but you don't feel guilty when you don't kill people.
Killed are not really clear. Even when you read the reports about protests and people killed in each individual protest, it'll be like 3 people, 5 people, and so it just didn't really add up to that many people. The protests were small and couldn't create a situation where they could force the government have Bashar al-Assad resign, and they were actually dwarfed by counter-protests and pro-government protests in the main cities. There was a few reasons why this happened. The defense forces contained and prevented the protesters from being able to occupy town squares and shut down towns. So they would have the protest, but they would get sort of run off the street, so they couldn't shut whole towns down. The protests were mostly in rural areas like Daraa, and also mostly in Sunni areas, and they couldn't really affect all the population. The opposition was mostly Western intellectuals who had little presence on the ground, poor rural Sunnis, conservative idealist Sunnis. So this is where the main bulk of the protesters were, and it just wasn't making a lot of inroads into the other groups. The protest movement drew a lot of sympathy in the West and in Sunni countries, but it failed in the non-Sunni countries, and it failed to draw in other Syrian groups into their arms. This is a couple of things. The business community wanted stability, particularly after seeing the chaos in Libya, Iraq, and Egypt. So they saw the Arab Spring had not gone so well. Even Bahrain, Yemen, this had not gone so well. So they were kind of a little bit reticent to support it. So they refused to strike or otherwise support the protests. The next part is the Syria is a semi-socialist state, so government was huge. And many people were not really, regardless of whether they were Sunni, Shia, Christian, what have you, they were not really interested in change of the system. The military is huge. And so a lot of people had military jobs or their relatives had military or government jobs and they weren't interested in seeing change. The minorities were mostly secular and feared a direct democracy which could have swept in a Sunni government and then therefore deprived them. And this is what happened in Iraq when a Sunni government, a Sunni dictatorship was overthrown. And then Shias won the elections and then the Sunnis were unhappy. Would have been the same sort of a deal that the 20 or 30% minority bulk of Druze, Alevites, Shias, would have, Christians would have lost out. And so they weren't really enthusiastic about supporting a democracy. The Sunnis were not actually united. Some of them were neutral. Some of them were pro. Some of them were actually pro-government. And so then you had the Sunnis, which represented the majority of the country, did not have a single position that, for instance, all of them were Bashar must go. Some of them would have been satisfied with economic reforms. Some of them wanted to keep the status quo because of military or government jobs. Some of them just didn't care. The complaints that the protesters had, which is that Bashar had been there too long, or Hafez had been there too long, or that they had crushed democracy before. They didn't really crush a democracy. They crushed an Islamist rebellion. Didn't really draw people in. So that the attempts by the West and inside Syria to paint Bashar as a villain also failed. Syria did not have a long history of democracy. So, and neither has the region. So people weren't really that upset by the concept of having one particular person or one particular family rule the country. So that in and of itself didn't make people upset. The other part that Bashar and the Alawites were Nusayri disbelievers working for a Shia regime, and that sort of thing drew the wrong types of attention. It drew Al-Qaeda and it drew Islamists, but it didn't really draw in the bulk of the Syrian population. It didn't draw in, moderate Sunnis. It didn't draw in secular Sunnis. So you had this huge group of people who were totally uneasy with the protest on the one hand, which is you had the minority groups, you had secular or moderate Sunnis, and urban Sunnis, people with government jobs, and then you had sort of rural farmers and idealist Sunnis and idealist liberals trying to draw in people to their movement, and it wasn't really able to just sort of sweep and take hold and everybody feel that they were a part of it. The Syrian economy was modernizing, and students and large cities and things like that refused to really join in the protests. You didn't see huge riots at Damascus University, for instance. Bashar was popular, and he seemed to be moving the country in the right direction. Bashar made democratic reforms, things in religious freedom, and they were easing in that direction even before the protests started. And then after the protests started, he ramped it up. So that sort of took a lot of the steam out of the wind out of the sails, if you were, steam out of the engines, whichever metaphor we're using, so that sort of held people back, and they didn't really quite want to join in. So if I want to sum up, why was Bashar not overtaken by a protest movement, and why did it go to a civil war? The opposition, which was mostly rural conservative Sunnis and westernized intellectuals, they lacked support. The next part is the strength of the security apparatus. The next part is this Bashar, because he was seen as a reformer who was taking the country in the right direction. So when they took up arms to defend themselves and were joined by army defectors who disobeyed orders to fire on the protesters, it was because the protest movement hadn't won, not because they had no choice. All of that put together meant that the protest movement alone couldn't overthrow Bashar, and so they had no choice but to take up arms, as it were, not to defend themselves from being shot, but to try to overthrow the government.
We're told armed gangs that once controlled all of Jisr al-Shughur are still a threat. Military officials tell us the crackdown here was unavoidable to stop terrorist elements whose aim is to bring down the Assad regime and establish an al-Qaeda-style Islamic state. Abdulrahman Nasheed is presented by government minders as an eyewitness. They were pretending to be peaceful demonstrators, but they had guns hidden here, he tells us.
Islamist insurgents are calling it the liberation of Jisr al-Shughur. For the first time in Syria's four-year conflict, an alliance of Islamist groups captured the strategic northwestern...
Just a dream.